from MLCon 2017 in Berlin. My name is Ann-Kathrin Klose, and with me today is Peter Bantiers. Hi, Peter.
Hi.
And we're going to talk about AI and if it's going to be a miracle or rather a menace for mankind. So in your talk, you started by elaborating a bit on what AI actually is. Can you give
us... I basically started off with comparing how human intelligence works and how we can map that onto computer algorithms, basically. And the idea is basically that we do a lot of stuff unconscious, which means that in our body or in our brains, we have these steps that we take. And those steps, we can call them algorithms. And we train those algorithms by learning from our environment, from what we see. And machine learning algorithms and AI actually work the same way. So you get a lot of examples, and you use those examples to create a pattern of steps. And that pattern of steps is just the execution algorithm. And so the two are actually very similar. But on the other hand, they work completely differently. And that's why I went into my talk about whether AI is a miracle or a menace, because we humans, we have a lot of background that machine learning algorithms don't have. So genetically, we are encoded to be group animals, to behave nicely with each other, not to kill each other, hopefully. But AI doesn't have that genetic encoding. So we have to be careful with what we create, that it won't extinguish mankind at some point.
So how do you actually train ML models, algorithms to be no threat to mankind? Are there certain things you need to look at?
Well, that's the scary thing about the whole story. So at this moment, we don't know yet. And there are two good reasons for that. The first one is that we haven't reached a level where AI can be that threatful yet. So AI is still very stupid. Insects are still smarter than everything we do in AI. But on the other hand, it's improving rapidly. So we haven't discovered ways to make sure that the AI does what it's supposed to do and not extinguish humankind. And on the other hand, since we aren't at that level yet, we haven't figured out to tell the algorithm it's making a mistake or not. Because the algorithm is learning from its mistakes and it's improving on that. So the technical part is also not there yet. But there are organizations like OpenAI, founded by Elon Musk, and I think also Stephen Hawking is supporting that organization, that are looking into exactly that, trying to figure out what we should do to make sure that if AI becomes really smart, that it won't kill us.
Okay, so Skynet would be possible, actually, or wouldn't it?
Well, Skynet is... it's not the thing that's going to happen. So Skynet is comes from the Terminator movies, where you have this killer robot killing all humankind with the purpose of killing humankind. But that's probably not the case that's going to happen, because that means you have to actively build an AI system with that purpose. And it's very unlikely that somebody will do that, because it will also kill himself. But on the other hand, what is more likely to happen is that, and that's what I call the coffee cup problem, is that you ask a machine learning algorithm to build something, for example, coffee cups. And you tell it, like, be the best and most successful coffee cup company in the world, and that's the only thing that you ask it. If you would let a system that's smart enough do that for 10, 15, or whatever years, so that it can go on the internet, find better ways to build coffee cups, find new resources, figure out how to be more profitable, and you would just go to Mars for 15 years on one of Elon Musk's rockets, and you come back, you will see that when you come back, the entire Earth will be converted into coffee cups, because what you have asked the algorithm is just to build coffee cups. You haven't set any boundaries around what it's allowed to do and what it's not allowed to do. And that's the scary part. There is no bad intention in AI, because it's not genetically encoded in or any other way encoded into the algorithm, but you've just asked it the wrong thing. So what we need to do is figure out ways to ask it the correct thing, so that we when we ask it something, we set it, we give it the right boundaries, so it won't overgo those boundaries.
Okay, but still, even if we don't get turned into coffee cups by AI, there will be some effects on society by the growing number of artificial intelligence systems, right?
Yeah, there will be huge effects, actually. And in my opinion, we're at the brink of the fourth industrial revolution. So we had the steam engine in the beginning of the 18th century, where a lot of things got automated, like making clothes and those things. Early 20th century, we had the petrochemical industry that gave us the cars. And more recently, we had the IT revolution, which gave us smartphones and the internet. And I think now we're at the brink of that fourth revolution, the AI revolution, where a lot more jobs can be automated. And if you look into the past, each of these industrial revolutions, they gave us a lot of prosperity and a lot of progress. We live longer, we live healthier. But on the other hand, when they happen, a lot of people lose their jobs. A lot of companies go bankrupt, and that's something that's going to happen. And the jobs that are going to disappear are the jobs that are in some way very repetitive. Because machine learning algorithms, they need a lot of examples. So if you can track what a person is doing in any way, you can gather these examples and you can automate that job. Where machine learning is really bad at is combining multiple sources, like, for example, being interdisciplinary, looking at, for example, physics, and you combine it with maybe geography or English or whatever. If you combine multiple sources, it becomes really hard. So we humans, we are actually really good at that, even though throughout our education, we're really forced into specific subjects. So if we focus on that, I think those jobs, they will survive and they will stick around. And we will have to train our people to be able to do that. But this transition from in this AI revolution will also make sure that a lot of companies will disappear. And whenever I'm in Germany, I like to refer to the car industry, because the car industry is really big and powerful and a big employer in Germany. But when you come up to a point where cars can drive themselves, they don't have to sit still in a parking lot. My car sits still, I think, 90 or 95% of the time. So it means that it could do 10 times more transportations than it does today. So it means that the amount of cars that you need on the road, sitting still in parking lots or driving around, will be reduced by a factor 10. So it also means that there will be 10 times less cars produced, and also 10 times less people working in the car industry. And that, in a sense, means that car companies that aren't actively working on that now and staying in front of the curve, they will go bankrupt at some point. And my expectation is that within this 10 and 15 years, you will see a lot of those companies disappear. And I'm afraid that in Germany, it will be, in the near term, a big disaster. But you will see it in other industries in other countries as well.
Okay, if you say in the near term, what about the time frame of this revolution? How much time have we left till computers are so intelligent we can't keep up with them?
So if you look at what researchers say, they guess between 2040 and the end of this century that we will reach artificial intelligence that is as smart as, for example, a machine learning engineer. So at the point where we reach the level of an AI engineer, at that point, if AI is that smart, it can start building its own AI. And that's the point where we reach singularity. So it's a technical term we use for that. So it also means that once that happens, AI will build itself, will improve itself, and we won't be able to follow it. If you ask my opinion, I think it will be in 2060 that we will be outsmarted by our own creation.
So how should we prepare for that point as a society in economic ways? Is there anything we could do?
Well, there are things we could do. Like organizations like OpenAI are really actively looking into making sure that these algorithms don't turn us into coffee cups or whatever. So I think we should follow what those organizations are doing, but I also think we should educate people about machine learning, but also about what the effects are of machine learning. And we also should look at how to prepare people that they are still relevant in the job market of tomorrow and the day after tomorrow. So if you know that algorithms are really good at reproducing what they have been taught, and humans, if you remember, well, at least my high school times, they were horrible because I was sitting in the class falling asleep. Because what I had to do is I had to reproduce what I was taught. But machine learning algorithms are super great at that. So if we stick to this paradigm where you teach math separately from geography, separately from English, French, or whatever language you're learning, you will create people that are not as good as machine learning algorithms, and you lose the ability that we all humans have where we can combine multiple things. So I think we should change our education paradigm from a single course perspective, so a single subject, to a multi-subject project-based system maybe, where you have a multidisciplinary project, and as a student you have to combine knowledge from different subjects into something new. Because that is what machine learning is really bad at, and it's really difficult. Because it's really hard to gather a lot of examples to create something like that. But from a single subject, it's really easy to get a lot of examples. So that will be completely replaced by automation.
So just to sum things up, miracle or minis?
Well, in this interview, it might have seemed that artificial intelligence has a lot of downsides, but it will also make sure that everything will become a lot cheaper. Our standard of life will increase, but we just have to prepare for what's coming. So in my opinion, it's a miracle, but we have to prepare.
Okay, thank you for this interview.
You're welcome.